Thank you very much for coming along this evening, for taking the time out. And for those of you who are watching this recorded, thank you for finding this content and for accessing it. So this is the beginning of what we hope is going to become a series of events that provide information about career paths for biology graduates. For this event, we have compiled together some interviews from employers. And so I'll be guiding that. And then I'm going to, towards the second half of this, hand it over to Libby, who's going to give us some guidance around the job market and cover letter writing. So just a note, this session is being recorded and it's going to be uploaded to our social media channels. And so these, if you are unfamiliar, I'm going to bring this slide, this page across. Hopefully you can see this. So this, the edited version of this presentation is going to end up sitting here in our Biology Massey University Albany YouTube channel. And actually, I'm going to be referring to this a little bit because this is where we've got these recorded clips sitting. So this recording is going to go here. Then it's going to be repeated out onto our Facebook page as well. So that is what is happening there. So it means that you can check this recording for all of the websites that I mention and other links. So no need to write anything down. All of the content that we're going to be presenting is going to be just recorded and made available after the fact. So this is our schedule. I'm going to move through just a brief welcome and just an introduction about for myself and Libby and you as well. We all probably know each other, but let us just make sure. And then I'm going to step through, and I'm going to take these first two here. So I'm going to present, as I mentioned, some pre-recorded interviews with employers, some clips from some longer interviews. And I'll speak about that once I'm into that section. And then after this, I'm going to do the same, but from the perspective of a recent graduate who has recently gotten a job. So we've interviewed a graduate student and he's going to offer his perspective. And then I'm going to hand this over to Libby and she's going to guide us through the second part here. So as I mentioned, thank you very much for taking the time out and for coming along. This is, it's wonderful that you're here. Who are we? That your host's presenting this. So there is a pretty good chance based on the courses that you've taken that you recognize us. And I, of course, recognize many names here. But there is a chance, given the group that I have sent this out to, and those of you who might be viewing this after the, once it's been recorded, that you're not exactly familiar with us. So I'm going to turn this over briefly to Libby so she can introduce herself.
Thank you, Daniel, and kia ora koutou. I'm a senior lecturer in marine ecology, but I essentially teach into a lot of the different majors. So I have come across, I think, a few of you in the past, and if I haven't, I look forward to maybe coming across you in the future. So I've tread this path of getting a job, and so hopefully we have some tidbits of information for you, and I hope that also this opens the dialogue to ask more questions down the line. So thanks for coming along and thanks, Daniel, for kicking things off.
Certainly. And so my name is Daniel Thomas. I primarily teach into zoology courses. Maybe I only teach into zoology courses. I'm the major leader for zoology here on the Albany campus. I have a counterpart who is the major leader at the Manawatu campus, and so that is Murray Potter. And I'm really invested in your careers. And so while I'm firmly centered in zoology, we recognize that zoology, of course, is often one part of a pairing with ecology and sustainability and marine biology as well. So that is us. Now, in terms of who you are, I have invited along to this session either graduates this year or soon to be graduates in our biology majors, our ecology and sustainability, marine biology, or zoology. So what this means is that I identified the 300 level, the third year courses across these majors, and this is who you are. I've contacted you to invite you to there. So some of you are going to be graduates this year, and some of you are going to be graduates pretty soon. So hopefully this content is relevant to you. So let us move on to the first part of this presentation. And this is the interviews with employers. So we've got two employers, employers of graduates that we reached out to and asked them a variety of questions. And so here they are here. They are Rebecca Bray from Tamaki Painga Hira Auckland War Memorial Museum. So Rebecca is Senior Collection Manager of Natural Sciences, and she oversees a pretty big team. And she's involved in hiring, and she hires graduates. And so it was Libby who interviewed Rebecca and has asked a variety of questions. And I'm going to show you a series of clips from that interview, and I'm going to link you through also to the longer interview. And likewise, we have we've reached out to and asked questions of Chris Wedding. And Chris is an ecology manager for bioresearchers, Babbage Consultants. So this is a group who are spending a lot of time in the field performing ecological biodiversity surveys and a lot of report writing around here. So we've got two great perspectives, a collections perspective, a ecological consultant perspective, and they offer some really great insight. So, and again, Libby or anyone else, do feel free to chime in here. I will say that Chris was interviewed by Wei Hong Ji, and in the clips that I'm going to show you, that actually Wei Hong does appear in some of the interviews as she's asking her questions. So what I have are a compilation. I'm going to play this pretty soon. It's about 5 minutes, and it's going to walk through a compilation of little clips, extracts from these interviews. And these interviews are chock full of great information, and they give you the perspective of the employer. So someone who is receiving your CV, receiving your cover letter, evaluating it and deciding whether or not you're going to make it through to that interview stage, and then someone who's going to be part of your interview potentially as well. So that is their perspective of these two that we've got here. And so that is the pearls of wisdom that they are offering up in these compilations, these interviews. So just before I jump into there, I'm going to just bring back my YouTube page. So when I'm talking about these longer interviews, they are the ones that are titled here, Making an Impact. So in this one, I've got about 13 minutes, 12 and a half minutes of Rebecca's interview. Over here, I've got Chris's interview. And so that is where you can find the full length interview. And we can see that I've got these other clips here, and they have got the little title cards. These are the extracts. And so these are these extracts that I've put together that I'm going to, that are listed here that I'm going to play soon. So just before I get there, I'm going to give you a little introduction about what's going on. There, in this series, it's going to alternate from Rebecca and then Chris, Rebecca, Chris, and they're going to be discussing various things. And these are the titles of what they're talking about. So they begin by talking about skills to highlight in your cover letter as you as a graduate when you are applying for that job. So this is Rebecca first up, and she's actually referring to a document, this graduate profile. It's essentially a summary of the traits that you have acquired as a BSc student. Then we jump over to Chris, and he offers similar things. He's actually mostly focusing on information he's pulled out of the ecology graduate profile for this one, but it's similarly relevant. Next, we have Rebecca, and she's going to be just telling you, giving information, some guidance about what to put into a cover letter to perhaps remind the employer that you're more than just your degree. You've got a whole lot of real world experience that you can bring to the job as well. Chris then is telling us what to highlight in the CV and cover letter, and he's really saying, think about the job and the company, do a little bit of research and really tailor your cover letter to the job that you're applying for. And the last clip is from Rebecca, and she's essentially pointing out, once you've made it through the cover letter and CV stage and you've been invited to an interview, this is your chance to really shine. So let me bring them up and we will get them underway. And I'm going to be keeping an eye on chat, so if there are sound issues, you can shout out and let me know. But let us get underway. So these are interviews with prospective employers.
Yeah, so it seemed like when I looked at it, a lot of the majors have really good coverage of a general biological understanding of the different kind of groups, so biodiversity and that kind of thing. So then we'd be looking for, like, what are you excited by within that? Also, there was a really great focus on teamwork and actually going in the field and seeing things and IDing, but also kind of handling stuff as well. It seemed like really practical areas. And then the emphasis on Tikanga Māori and Mataranga Māori, I think, particularly for Auckland Museum, is a really important thing that people are kind of growing up and in their graduate careers already within that, rather than having to learn it once they get to the workplace. It's just part of how people start going through university, which is really great.
Certainly, some of the skill sets that really stood out for me from my perspective using relevant technology is a really good one. So I picked up that from one of your profiles, and so on a daily basis, our ecologists will use GPSs. We'll have a good understanding of GIS tools. Be able to map. Undertake mapping, prepares maps, and we'd map out vegetation, we'd map out ecosystems, that kind of thing. So it's really, it's really important. Critical thinking is a really important one as well. So understanding the information you're looking at, and but being able to critically analyze it as well is a really important skill set.
So I guess you can always, for these things, draw from your experience outside of your degree as well. So in terms of things with teamwork and communication, if you've had other roles, be it in front of house service industries or anything like that, you'll have learned things and gained ways of working with people from that as well, that you've got all of your skills scientifically that you learn in your degree, but there's a whole life experience outside of that as well that you can draw from. So take opportunities as they come and kind of try and get that experience along the way as well, the practical experience. Yeah. Every opportunity is a chance to kind of build your tool belt. And so you never know when that's going to be useful. I feel like there's no... anything you learn at some point, it's going to pop up as a useful thing in career or life. I think through my undergrad and everything like that, I really tried to jump at every chance I get, because I probably wouldn't have got the roles I had without doing a bunch of volunteering and just learning as much as possible.
I suppose a lot of the typical type of typical sorts of traits that you'd expect to be able to demonstrate in a CV. So we're looking for someone who presents with confidence, enthusiasm, and shows initiative. Someone who understands the company. So someone who is providing a CV to me would I'd be interested or be very interested to know what they knew about our company, what they knew about the potential job, just understanding what we do in the industry is a really important aspect of an entry level. Just as much as understanding the ecological concepts that you would have picked up in your undergraduate degree as well. But having a good understanding about what we do in practice and how you could adapt your skill sets to assist us in undertaking some of that work would be really important.
When we are assessing applications. So if we think about the kind of resume and cover letter process, that's really to get you through the door into the interview. So you're wanting to look at that position description and address what's in there. So we're looking to kind of see if people have got the skills that we're going to need for the role. And then the interview process is finding out more about them and are they the right fit for the role. So they can, if we're interviewing someone, that means they can do it. But are they going to be the right fit? So kind of asking more of those questions around teamwork and team fit, as well as getting a little bit more detail about your ability to do the role. So when you're interviewing, what we're really looking for is kind of actual examples of experience, so times that you've done a thing. So if you get an interview for a role, it'd be really great to go back and look at that position description and come up with some examples in advance of where you think things meet the position description, because the questions will be based around that.
Right. And so those are a couple of perspectives there. And like I said, these are clips that are available on this page. And so you've always got access to those if you want to go back over some of the comments that they said, and they are part of these larger interviews. You may have a few questions about these. What I would ask is at this stage, just jot them down and we'll come back and we'll have a bit of a discussion towards the end. But right now, what I want to do is move on and offer you a perspective from the other side. And that is, rather than the perspective of the employer, this is someone who has recently gone through and recently been successful in gaining a job. And so this is one of our recent graduates. Now, I'm going to play you a couple of clips from an interview that I did with Michael Scarrow. Michael is a former BSc student here, but he's also a former master's student. And so this is something to keep in mind, that the job that he's going to be describing is one that he has gotten actually not just because of his BSc, but because he also gained some his skills and this extra qualification through his master's. Michael completed his, and this is described in his full interview, but he's completed his master's working with Dr. Luis Ortiz Cathedral, working in a conservation space. And then after his master's has actually been reasonably successful. He has gained employment with Ministry for Primary Industries, Department of Conservation, and he now has a job working for the New South Wales government. So I've got two clips here, just two, unlike the five that I just showed you before. And these two, the first one is actually talking about the job description and your limitations. So that is, you might be looking at a job and you think, oh, I'd really like to do this job, but I don't fill all of the criteria. And so Michael is going to offer some advice to say, don't let that put you off. So you will have some skills, something that you can speak to, you can address some of these points. And even if you miss them entirely, you can certainly be open about this in your cover letter and acknowledge your willingness to learn. So this is the first point that Michael is making. And then the next one is, Michael's going to offer his own perspective on when he wrote the cover letter for the job that he was recently hired for. And so this is, he's recently been employed as a project officer, and he describes this in his full interview. And again, that's available on the YouTube channel, on the Biology, Albany Biology YouTube channel. But he's going to highlight just a couple of things that he recalls from putting into his cover letter. So I'll get that clip started.
I think not being afraid to admit your limitations is one that I think a lot of people sort of steer clear of, maybe in the interview process, or they get sort of scared off for applying for a job just because they may not meet a certain specification. Being able to say, hey, look, I may not know this exact thing, but I've done something similar, which I can take my skills from here and apply them to this thing that I may not have expertise in yet. And a lot of workplaces, they're part of their job is to build your skills and develop you as a person, because at the end of the day, they want an effective employee. So by saying, yeah, this is what I know, this is where my limitations are, they can help build you up as well. So whenever I'm looking to write a cover letter, I typically try to keep it to probably 1 to 2 pages, as to not overwhelm whoever's going to be looking at it. The cover letter is typically a place where you try your best to sell yourself to the potential employer. So highlighting things that are going to be relevant to the role or position you're applying for. For the project officer role, I highlighted the fact that I'd recently completed a Master of Science in Conservation Biology at Massey. So that related directly to the desktop assessment side of things that we've been doing. And then after that, I sort of expanded and talked about the experience I had at DOC working in the field, because obviously there's a field component of the role. Discussing things like workplace health and safety is often a big one for employers, because they want to be able to see that you're able to work in an environment safely. So if you're going outside of your workplace, they know you're going to be safe and you're going to make an effort to keep others safe, as well as when you're working indoors in the office. And then what else did I discuss here? Just looking. And then it was another expansion on some of my previous experience. So looking at things like logistics, so field trip planning and things like that, which again tie back into the role that I'm doing at the moment. And then to finish off, I sort of discussed how each of these things related back to the job description that they issued when they request people to send in applications. And then a quick bullet point of things or attributes that may be desirable to your employer. So talking about things like professionalism, interpersonal communication skills, knowledge of wildlife monitoring, proficiency with computer software systems is also a good one. Really depends on the role that you're going to be doing, but I highlighted here use of Microsoft Office, data entry and analysis, so using statistical software like R, or what's become quite relevant to this role is using ArcMap or ArcGIS. And then also full driver's license, experience in first aid and work safe procedures, that sort of thing.
Okay, so that is Michael's perspective on writing mini cover letters, and he actually describes this in a wee bit more detail in his interview, which again is available online. So again, I hope that was valuable. You may have questions or comments, and if you can just sit on those for a little bit longer and we'll come back to that for our discussion at the end. At this point, I'm going to hand over to Libby, and Libby is going to offer her input.
Thanks, Daniel. So given that really great feedback that you've had from employers and someone who's tread this path really recently, what I want to do now is just highlight, I guess, what's in the current job market, and I guess how you would draw on that, those learnings you've just learnt in your own application potentially for a current job that's advertised. So first things first is knowing where to look for a job. So as I see it, there's sort of three different pathways that you might want to consider and think about what might work for you or what opportunities you might have. So the first is that you may already have a personal relationship with someone who works in a workplace that you would also like to work in. or you may already know very well the organization you want to be part of. So in those cases, there's nothing wrong with reaching out and saying, hey, this is who I am. You know, have a CV on hand and just express your interest in working in their organization and why. That kind of proactivity can speak volumes. So if you are quite decided about where you want to work or the kind of industry you want to work in, and you can approach someone, they will then have you on their radar for job opportunities as they come up. So that's something that might work for you. You don't want to overstep. So, you know, if it's a very far removed contact that you have, this may not be the pathway for you, but I would say that you can create your own opportunities in this way. So have a think about that. Another way to find out about the job market is obviously the websites that advertise jobs. So I've listed a few here. There's NZ Con Jobs or Conservation Jobs, NRM Jobs, which I understand is Australia only, and Seek is one of the main ones in New Zealand. We're going to have a look at some of the jobs that are advertised at Seek at the moment, just to give you an overview. But before we move on to that, the third way I just want to encourage you to look for jobs is to build a bit of a profile for yourself. So I'm sure you've all heard of LinkedIn. I'm terrible. I don't interact with it much, but it is a really useful forum for moving between jobs and getting to know what jobs are out there. So in LinkedIn, you essentially are able to make up your own profile for free. And I guess host your own CV on their website. And when you do that, make a point of connecting with people you know who also have LinkedIn profiles or organizations that might have LinkedIn profiles. What it means is that you become part of a network of people and you get made aware when job opportunities come up or when there's certain conversations going on around job opportunities. And you may even have people reach out to you based on the credentials you have listed on your LinkedIn profile. Cool. So if we just move on now and look at some of those job opportunities, I've chosen three that I think are quite diverse, hoping that, you know, at least one will resonate with each of you. And I guess the take-home message from all of this is that they're not advertised in the same format. And not the same recipe of cover letter and CV will work across all jobs. So just keep that in mind as we look at these now. So the first one is with Department of Conservation, and it's for a ranger position. And you'll see that there's actually a number of different ranger positions advertised presently. And again, they're each quite unique. So the first thing you want to do when you look at a job is really read all of the information and make sure first and foremost that this is a role that you want and that you can see yourself in. I've been in the position where I've advertised a job and people have applied without the intention of actually taking it up. And I guess I would encourage you to take opportunities, but to also follow through. So if you want to try out a job, that's completely fine, but you know that you're going into the interview with some kind of, I guess, unspoken contract that you have an actual intention to fulfill that role. And that will speak volumes. New Zealand's not a tiny place, but it's not a huge place either. And what I found with some of our graduate students is they've got jobs through having a good reputation of following through and being a good human being, basically. So these sorts of small actions really do count. So first of all, make sure you're actually interested in the job. Secondly, look at all those key accountabilities, and you'll find that the way that the job is described is quite different in many cases. So in this role, we have a whole bunch of bullet points. And certainly these are the things that you'll want to address in your cover letter and also in your CV. But there's also lots of other things that aren't directly, I guess, obvious that you should address. So there's some text there that sits outside of the bullet points. And these are also important things to address. They're telling you this information for a reason. They want you to know about their organization, and they want you to care about the organization and the kind of role that you will have. Be careful in the way that you address the accountability. So in some cases, it may make sense to address it almost in a bullet point manner. But what you'll note is if you look closely at this example, there's a little bit of redundancy across the sections. So you wouldn't want to repeat yourself unnecessarily. Like Michael said, you want to keep that cover letter quite short, as short as possible. So just make sure you're not unnecessarily repeating yourself and that each sentence that you're providing that very busy employer is actually meaningful and is going to speak volumes for you. Just to reiterate the case or the importance of making sure you tailor your CV and cover letter to the job, I would go as far as even highlighting or using the same terminology that they use. So here they talk about animal pest control operations and weed treatment tasks. Maybe you've done weeding in the past, but you might instead say that you've done weed treatment tasks. So that phrasing becomes important when you're a really busy employer and you've got a particular search image, you know the kind of person you're looking for. You're looking for those same words that you've put in the application advice. So make sure to redo your CV and cover letter for every position and make sure that it really is tailored to that. There's a few things here I just want to highlight. So you might find that you don't tick all of these accountabilities, but certainly I'm sure that all of you in your life experience can make a case for being on time, working within a budget, and probably reporting on progress. So these are things that, you know, it may even be part of some undergraduate program that you've had where you've had to report at different stages of the research or the project. And within another role unrelated to science, you probably worked on time with time budgets and also financial budgets. So don't be afraid to draw from that experience from things outside of science. Cool, so if we move to the next one, next job I've got here, this is quite a different role. And it's for Blake, and it's all about being an educator in issues around oceans and sustainability. So this is an example where it's really important to find out about the organization. So there's probably a core set of values that Blake works by, and being familiar with those so that you can put some of those important keywords into your cover letter would be really important and would speak volumes for your commitment to their vision and being an employee at their organization. It's also the kinds of things that would be really important to bring up in an interview if you were to get to that second stage. There may be a few things here that are outside of that science career, that portfolio that you have now that you're going to be a graduate of Massey. So things that may be relevant maybe to your school experience. So if you've mentored younger students at periods of time, or you've coached a sports team, or maybe you've been a class rep in one of your classes, whether that be in high school or now during your undergrad degree, those are the kinds of things that are really important. Also, examples that are quite uncomfortable sometimes to give. So evidence that you have a bubbly personality or a personality that people want to listen to. So maybe drawing examples where you've been promoted to be the speaker on behalf of a group, even if it's a classroom activity where you were the one that was presenting the presenting the project to the broader class. Those sorts of things become important, and no one feels comfortable about writing those things, but it is the only way that they're going to find out about those things or those aspects of you which are hard to understand based just on a CV and a cover letter. And sometimes you have to face that uncomfortable truth of writing them down so that you can get in the door and show them in person when you actually get to meet them. Fingers crossed you get to the interview. And the last one that I just wanted to share with you is quite a different one. So this is for more of a technical role, and it's with Ministry for Primary Industries. So this is one where there's a number of, I guess, tick boxes, which may or may not be ticked by you at this present time. So they're looking for someone who has experience working in laboratories and potentially in different kinds of managed areas. So PC2 is a physical containment facility. This is a situation where if you've done some lab work during your undergrad degree, it might be worth talking to your lecturer about what kind of laboratory were you working in and what kind of standard were you working to. Because you may find that some of these technical words that they've listed here are things that you've actually done within your degree. We just haven't necessarily painted it as such. The other thing is that you may not tick all these boxes, and this is something that Michael said. And also if you listen to the longer interview from Beck, she also reiterates that, you know, if you don't actually meet some of the criteria, that's actually an opportunity to I guess, express your enthusiasm to learn more or to grow in that way. And I would also say that, you know, even though you're nearing the end of your Bachelor of Science, I'm sorry, but learning does not finish. So you're still affiliated with Massey. You still have a wealth of people and resources around you. So I would encourage you to take those opportunities. There may be some volunteering opportunities over the next few months or even over the semester break or the summer period, depending on when you're finishing. There may be summer studentships that would help you get up to scratch with your PC2 lab abilities. And if we flip to the last slide, another really important thing is that Massey is an online university and we have a lot of free learning opportunities. And one, I think that if you look across these different job advertisements or these different organizations, you'll come to understand that an understanding of te reo Māori and tikanga Māori is very important. It's very important to Massey as well, but you may have learnt, I guess, different amounts in your degree depending on what specific courses you've taken. And of course, like I said, there's no limit to the learning, so I'm sure that there's lots more. Which are offered by Massey for you free. Just register, there's an app, you can do it on your phone, and they're very short and succinct courses that will help you to tick those boxes that will actually be really important and show that you're really proactive. You know, you want to learn and extend yourself, even extracurricular outside of your core degree. So I think that really speaks volumes. And the last thing I'll say is if you still feel like you really need to gain some experience, we are actually running a postgrad information lunch in a couple of weeks, so June 2nd. You may be committed at this point to go into the job market. Come along anyway. Just hear about what you could do if you know you try for a while and you decide that actually the kinds of jobs that you really want, you're not quite there yet. Come and learn about what postgrad studies might offer you. So we'll be talking about the different kinds of courses and postgraduate degrees you can take. And I'm not saying at all that you're not qualified enough to get a job at this stage, but it is your path that you're forging. And so, there's different ways to get to the place you want to go and different people do things differently. But one thing I would say is there's certainly no hurry. So stepping stones are really important. I think that most people who are now in their dream job, it wasn't their first job. It was one that came after a couple of different incidental jobs that helped them understand what they want to do or help them form those networks that they really need or become the person that they needed to be to get that job. So for you, postgrad might be that. For many of you, postgrad will not be that, but you're welcome to come along and hear about it regardless. Thanks, Daniel. I think that's all that I wanted to share with the group, but please add your thoughts as well.
That was wonderful. Thank you very much, Libby. All right. I'm going to turn us over now to, I'm going to open us up for discussion rather, and I'm just going to enter chat. I've put a little survey. So just as we're discussing, if you do want to offer your thoughts about this little event that Libby and I have hosted, then we would welcome them through this survey, or you can reach out to us directly. And this survey is also going to ask about your university experience as well, a few questions there. And so the reason we're gathering this information is essentially for improvement. What did you find was useful or missing from this event that we can fix basically into the future? And likewise, what job content can we perhaps bring into the undergraduate degree that we might be able to make improvements. So that is now sitting there in chat, but what I will do is open this up. So if you've got any questions, please feel free to fire them through into chat or to unmute yourself and ask away.
Yes, I have a quick question.
Go for it.
So at this stage, I'm not particularly ready to progress as far as studying for my master's degree, but I am interested in doing other courses that could benefit me on my career path. Are there anything that you would quite recommend more than others, such as SiteSafe, GrowSafe, chemical applications courses, 4x4, ATV off-road.
So you're referencing sort of more skills-based courses outside of a university? Is that so more practical-based things?
Yes, just something that I could do that only requires a few days to a week's worth of time that I could slowly progress and take more and more to make myself more up to date as well as employable.
Sure, no, I can certainly see the advantage. Now, I actually don't specifically know, but, and again, I'll finish this thought and then throw it open to Libby and anyone else to contribute. The best I can really offer is, in essence, to provide a bit of guidance. So if you reach out to me via email and then describe this, and then you and I can start a dialogue and I can perhaps point you towards some resources. But at the moment, I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah, and I'll just say the same. I have a bit of knowledge around the practical skills you require to work in the marine industry. So I can certainly give advice around boating and diving, first aid and those sorts of things. I would say that in terms of first aid, there are a lot of opportunities through the university, and those courses are only a couple of days. And there's also lots of opportunities outside of university, different community centres, and that would be fairly important. The other thing is, you know, if you know the kind of organisation you want to work in, or the kind of industry you want to work in, there's no harm in reaching out to people within that industry. They would be able to tell you the exact certifications that you would need to get that entry-level position that you want within that industry. And that's really the best way to make sure that you're on the right path, because it can be a bit of a minefield out there in New Zealand with WorkSafe and, you know, what credentials actually tick the box. And not all providers are the same.
Okay, thank you very much.
I've got a question.
Please.
So I'm very interested in doing postgraduate study, but my biggest worry is that I won't be able to work during it. I'm not really sure, and I probably should ask it at that evening that you said, or that lunch that's coming up. But is there sort of the option to do work in the field you want as well as postgraduate study? Do employers support that, or is it an avenue that you can go down?
Yeah, so certainly a lot of postgraduate students work at the same time, and often that is in a related or similar industry to what they're studying in. Sometimes it's even a very formal arrangement, so you'll see that some workplaces actually offer the opportunity to study within their institution or within your role in that institution. Those positions are hard to get. You generally need to know someone there already. But yeah, I would say that anything's possible. It's a matter of having a dialogue, and, you know, depending on what supervisor you have or want, they may also know some opportunities and put you in touch with the right people. But I would say that it's pretty normal to work alongside your postgraduate studies. And as a supervisor, we're really sympathetic to that. We know that this is a time for you to also foster those other sides of your person, and also you need to support yourself.
Yeah, cool. Thank you.
Any other questions anyone wants to ask? So I've got a question here in chat. So will there be another postgrad info session next semester if we can't make this one coming up in June?
Yeah, definitely. We tend to run them every semester, so there will be one. And it tends to be always a Wednesday lunchtime, unless you tell me that that's a terrible time. And it's usually the second to last week in semester, maybe shuffled for some unknown reasons that I can't forecast right now, but that's a general timing.
And then I have a question here about volunteer work. So one of the points that Rebecca from the museum made was really build up your CV, your toolbox, your tool belt, as much as you can. And one of the ways of doing this, and something that Rebecca's had a lot of success from, was volunteering. And so how do we find out about volunteering opportunities here at Massey? And really the short answer is to reach out to specific researchers or heads of labs and ask them what they've got going on and if there's a way that you can contribute to it.
Yeah, and actually, I remember now, Daniel, you jog my memory. Rebecca said that actually they advertise volunteer opportunities for the museum on their webpage.
Yeah.
So if there are certain organizations or kinds of work that you want experience in, have a look at those places' websites and search around for volunteer opportunities.
Do we have any other questions, either typed into chat or asked? I've got any entry-level BSc work will help build my experience. Is it? I see. Yes, this used to be a much, let me rephrase. Yes, there are opportunities for work at a university during your undergrad. They mostly take the form of demonstrating. And so this can be very valuable because it shows an application of your knowledge and it also is a leadership role as well. There are, as we move forward, we are hoping that there will be more of those types of opportunities in the near future. Yes, I understand that volunteering can be a challenge, especially if you're studying and working, and then there is this extra expectation. And so, of course, it is best if that is paid work. I completely understand that. And so, while, of course, you want to build up your tool belt and your CV, you need to do what is best for you, and you certainly shouldn't be overreaching. All right, if we've got no other questions, what I'm going to do is invite you again to provide any feedback through my little, here it is here. But you're welcome to just fire through an email to me, and I imagine Libby as well.
Yeah.
If you've got any follow-up questions or any other thoughts, we're of course welcome. You're welcome to contact us, and we will, we might be able to direct you towards resources or address any other questions. Libby, any final points?
No, but I would just say, well done. You've taken the first step. You're being proactive and finding out more about what comes next. So take that and run with it. And we're here to help.
Great. All right. Well, I will stop this sharing and I will end the session. And thank you very much for coming along.